Welcome back. The show is called Yapulay Bonuses. So this Arua, there's crazy stuff that comes out of Arua, but right now they are going for the kill, man. Because man, the things that are coming out of Arua. So a 19-year-old. First, I want you to pay attention to the statement I'm about to say, because you might think I'm making this up. Police Uganda posted on Facebook that a 19-year-old stole a bus with passengers. Can you believe it? A 19-year-old. Do you know how a 19-year-old boy looks like? I'm just going to give you a visual. A 19-year-old boy is between, is like Fefe Busi. Okay, Fefe Busi is old because apparently about 10 years ago, he was asking for some from Lydia Jasmine. But a 19-year-old typically looks like Fefe Busi, right? Because you're seeing the picture of that guy. That's the boy. Look at how he's dressed. Look at how he looks like. So apparently the story is that the driver was warming the bus. They say that it's warming, but they are really trying to lie to us that the bus is about to take off. Yet you know that you still have 5 hours waiting for it to fill up. So when it was sitting, that boy you're seeing, you look at how Ramshakodi looks like. He steps into this bus, and the town boy, your conductor, hey, driver, he also bought into the line. And all the people that were seated in the bus who could clearly see this boy were like, this is our driver. And he drove them. Until at one moment, the band boy, I think he became somebody, was like, wait a minute, where is this guy taking us? And why does he look so young? And why does he look like, why is he smelling? Because you can see clearly this boy doesn't bathe. And why does he have a shirt that looks dirty? Then that's when they realized that, oh my God, we are being stolen. So in that moment, they all panic. They're like, oh my God, we are being stolen. Jesus Christ. So now, I want to be angry at the boy. But I can't be angry at that boy. I think that there is a lot of stupidity that is going on in Arua. I don't know what is going on, but how does that happen? How does that boy, look at how he looks like. How does that boy, Jesus Christ, if this can happen in Arua, that means that everything is possible in Arua. I think that Henry Lukoma can have a concert in Arua and all of you will turn up and support and listen to that noise pollution for 1 hour. Say again. There comes something to say that maybe people are easy to manipulate. I mean, there are some things that you don't even have to be like, where did he pass? Ah, man. President Museveni, we need your help. I think in Uganda, we're going to be going right now. At first, I used to think that the most miserable thing in Uganda is President Museveni naming Butcherman a presidential advisor. But every time you think that it's so ridiculous in Uganda, someone comes and tops it up, right? You couldn't suspect anything. You couldn't say that this boy is unfit. This is a bus, for crying out loud. A bus, I don't care what you are, a bus cannot be, first of all, driven by a skinny person, and a bus cannot be driven by a young person. Even if you're old and skinny, still to Jakugana. Imagine you sit like in a bus, and the person that comes to drive that bus, guess who shows up? Can you really stay in that bus? Can you feel something? There's nothing that tickles in your brain and tells you, this person doesn't know what they're doing. Okay, maybe that's not the most logical part. But I'm just wondering what... First of all, I'm even confused. When a conductor is, when the bus is going to take off, the conductor does not know how to talk to the driver. Tibete gira. And people come up and blame that President Museveni is the reason why the country is going to the dogs. Are you sure that people like to say that the country is going to the dogs? Are you sure even the dogs want us? A 19-year-old boy, ababi abantu abakuru, shite gira. It's like if you're in a class, let me give you another example. It's like if you're in a class, maybe masters, you're doing a postgraduate program, right? Postgraduate program. And then the person that comes to teach is like fresh kid. And then say, today we are studying. Like no one could be like, wait a minute. This is not working out. The incident occurred today at 9:30 a.m. That means that no one was drunk. It is 9:30 a.m. You know, if I'd taken off the bus like at midnight, it would be like, maybe they had come from that alcohol of Black Friday. No, this was 9:30 a.m. in the morning. You know, it's alleged that the driver bus started to warm the engine of the bus, preparing for a long journey in Kampala, at the same time waiting for passengers. Andama, who is not a staff of the company, entered into the bus and drove it with 16 passengers for 5 kilometers along Kampala Road. 5 kilometers! That's a long distance, right? That's like from here up to what? Chireka or up to Bweyogere. The townman, who did not suspect a wrong driver in the bus simply entered into it and continued for all the distance before confirming that the driver was a wrong person. So either this boy, maybe if this boy was auditioning for a job, they probably should give him this freaking job, man. Just play with people's lives, man. Like this bus company, actually someone can sue this bus company. How does a bus leave the park and there's not been any test, there's not been anyone who supervises, you know? Next thing you will hear is that one of these days you're going to hear on the news and they tell you that Uganda Airlines just took off. And who was driving, who was piloting Don Zelaya? Oh my God. Is this the first time it's happening? What if this boy is a serial bus driver? What if he has ever driven people all the way from Arua up to Kampala? This is the first time they are catching him. At the end of the day, Nilestar as a bus, you need to put out an official apology. You need to talk to these people one by one if they have the number on the ticketing and you apologize in person. This is not funny. Someone can get hurt, someone can die, and they leave behind street kids. And when they leave behind street kids, that's how we end up with people like Grenade, who is a street kid without a father to take care of him. And he sleeps with men, women, dogs, cows, pigs, just to make a living in this city. So this is a big... Okay, Grenade, that was not... That was below that belt. So let me just read some comments, because apparently, of course, I can't be the only one that thinks that this is the most ridiculous thing that ever happened on the planet. Medi Alexis, this boy desires a driving license. Get more training in driving and be given a job in driving under monitoring. He can be a great bus driver than arresting him, because man, in the picture you can see is at the police post. Then there is Tim K. Moore. He was ready to show that he has the skills, and good enough he did this without injuring anyone or damaging the vehicle. He actually deserves a proper training. Can you believe all of you are on the side of this boy? And that really shows you that in Uganda, mwena, imuribafu. All of you on the side of a 19-year-old boy stealing a bus and driving. Yeah, the show is really up. Reliable intellect. We are under edutainment section, under vision group. People, if you go up in Magulumba, forget journalism and editorial. This is real journalism. Okay, Lugambo, really. But you know, this is, like, so, you know, guys, every time I'm walking in the Vision Group compound and they meet me, they're like, man, what do you do? Why are you there? Lugambo, you're an embarrassment to principles of journalism. Lugambo, well, you need to ask yourself, why is that people want to listen to what I have to say instead of listening to you people who are so journalistic? Magufuli is also attacking us in Tanzania, saying that comedians and DJs should not work on TV. What? That's not fair. Okay, maybe DJs. I mean, Shiru, really? On TV? No. DJ Cream? No. But comedians, we are. I don't even know how I ended up here. I was supposed to be a doctor. But sometimes when I want to ask maybe this serious, Ngamba, thank God I'm here. I'm going to show you this house. Yeah, you can see that house, right? That is an engineer, right? This is a man who paid tuition to go through. Man, Jesus Christ. Are you saying that you can tell this building is falling anytime? But it's still building. And I think that even the manager is coming and asking him or the boss, Namgamba, are you sure this is going to hold? He's like, are you kidding me? I've done this enough times. bro. So sometimes some of us who are in this place, yo, man, we are people who are, we are the chosen few. You can follow me on social media. That's too much. Yo, to SM it what I really job on Facebook. Yeah. 200,000, man. I am followed by more people than some of these politicians get voted. I have more. The people, how many votes did Otunu get? Because he also forgot to vote himself. Then he got like one vote from one of those girls that has a crush on him. Then they ask Otunu, why did you not vote for yourself? He's like, I did not vote for myself because the election is a sham. So what were you doing all these 5 years campaigning, man? So Otunu, talk to me nicely. I can send some voters to you. Plus a little bit of money. Listen, everyone is eating this election money apart from me. When someone connect me, man. I have a lot of people that watch what I do, man. Connect me. So anyway, Dr. Kano Kizza-Besigye, the man of the hour. Apparently, he comes out and he says that religious people, he's asking for religious people to support, to help liberate the country. Now, this is why I keep on telling you that opposition in Uganda has a very big problem. You hear his logic. He was like, the Bible, oh God, teaches equality, that all of us are equal. And so, this system working for a few people is bad. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That this system of Uganda working for a few people is bad and it's not consistent with what religion teaches us. And I'm like, does this guy know how religion works? Has religion ever worked for everybody? Mbonyi has four cars. Four cars, Range Rovers. Each Range Rover is about 150 million. That's around over 1.2 billion. His followers have what? Ruyonga just has only gray hair. And then he makes a voiceover. Live, coming live, okay? Coming to you live from heaven. Can you believe Ruyonga? A genius rapper. You know there's no poet who's stupid. There are many musicians who are stupid when we're spicy. A rapper can't be stupid because rap actually involves creativity. Grammar and gloss and what? Elegance. A rap person, a rapper, like the myth, or GNL, you have to be a poet, you have to be brilliant. To see that a man like that, he can actually think it's a good deal to go to Mbonyi and says this is a broadcast from heaven. Yet, everybody wants to charge on the kubafu. Just in the name of praising Mbonyi. That is why I tell you that opposition namwete mufaibi mwogera. Religion has never worked for everybody. Religion is one of the most divisive things on the face of the universe. It is sexist. That's the first thing. There's no women in leadership in religion. When they are there, it's like people are not liking them. Have we ever had a black pope? I think we should make bad black a pope. That would be fun. There would be some little bit of spice in the Vatican. Secondly, religion encourages division and separatism and apartheid. Can you believe people like in these local churches or in these religious churches? They hate each other. They hate each other. Like the crowds in Pentecostal churches, they will talk down on people in spiritual churches, in these traditional Anglican churches. You know, okay, I know that the reverends once in a while sleep like with every woman in the choir and the ushers, but you know that's just a minor weakness. We can close our eyes to it. Similarly, also likewise, the people in these churches, the traditional churches, the Anglican churches, and the Catholic churches, also, so all of these people are into cults. So when you say that the system should work for everybody, just like religion, what are you talking about? When has religion ever worked for everybody? Religion doesn't work for everybody. It works for a select few. Me, I grew up in the Anglican church in the village. And whenever you would come and sit in front, and you, if you come early for the service and you sit in front, because you know that the one person who became successful in the village, who is maybe an MP by then, Naja Muchachi. You see the usher coming and telling you, what about me? Yeah, I know, go back. Yeah, but I came here first. I should be the one to talk to God. They're like, well, God doesn't really think you're supposed to be sitting here. God thinks that MP should be the one sitting here. Then you argue. And then at the end of the day, they bring a man who's bigger now. Because now they know you're just despising these small people. Like they are bouncing you in the presence of God. Can you believe that? Like God is there saying, let all the kids come unto me. And they are bouncing you to bring a corrupt politician to be the one seated in front. That is how corrupt the Anglican church is. And that Anglican church can, much as it's corrupt like that, or it's not that working for everybody, it actually can hold a candle to these born-again churches. Because for them, those ones are the worst on earth. People who are known to be donating a particular amount of dollars can even get the WhatsApp number of the prophet or the pastor. Did you know that? Like these pastors in churches, if you give in bitano bitano, tosora na muku bidanga kwa tesimu, who the hell are you? Pastor. Now, if these rich Americans come and donate $50,000, he invites them over, then they lead service. He's like, we want to thank our brother from United States, from Canada. Then they move around the church. Then they go, they show him. Then the pastor asks him, are you feeling horny? Can we get for you one of the girls in the choir? He's like, oh, it's okay. He's like, do you? Like, they do everything to impress these people. Okay, that was a sexist example. But you get what I'm trying to say, right? Like, church has never worked for everybody. So what do you mean when you come to us, not Siriwaza, that this government, if anything, this government of President Museveni functions better than churches? Okay, now that I think about it, that's a point of contention. But Museveni at least is going to work for the anti-corruption work. I need to be there. That is going to be hilarious. President Museveni working anti-corruption work? What? What? That's like Mbonyi heading a walk that is saying that pastors or ministers of God should stop asking money from the congregation. And Mbonyi is at the forefront also walking. Anyway, moving on from that, HIV. There is only 1.4 million people with HIV. Only 1.4 million people as of 2018. Out of 40 million people. Do you know what that means? If a girl doesn't give you raw or live, takwagara, there is no HIV in Uganda. 1.4 is little, man. By the way. Jokes aside, I think this is a very, very big plus on for us as people in Uganda. That's why most of you people who are always running from men to men or from women to women and you're not using protection are still safe. The fight against HIV in this country has really been a successful fight. So once in a while, maybe we need to clap up for... Okay, the budget of the Ministry of Health is donated is like 80%. But at least that's a good thing. We don't have AIDS. We don't have HIV. And even if you have HIV... I mean, these days HIV is like ulcers, really. You just live with it for the rest of your life. Stay here. So, man, it's a good thing. I felt happy about this. And yesterday was World AIDS Day on December 1st. You know, I always find it funny. What if you actually got HIV on World AIDS Day, like on December 1st? Are you special on that day? Okay, my God, I can't even just say that. Anyway, it was World AIDS Day, and what we're trying to do is we're trying to break the stigma. Just because MC Katz has AIDS, don't be afraid of shaking his hand. Don't hug him. He might give it to you. But, you know, MC Katz doesn't have HIV. That's just that. I am making up. So HIV, we're trying to break the stigma. You people, if you have HIV, go know your status. You know your status before you start spreading it around. And if you know that you're HIV positive, go and take medication. You know, and if there's probably one person who you don't like, can give you a little bit of HIV, you know. Who knows, man? You just kill a few people who are bad. I mean, think about it. Like, if you had to give HIV to one of these prophets who keep on lying to us that they can heal HIV and end up stealing money from us, just give Mbonye some little bit of the insect. Is that even supposed to be said on air? Can you make jokes like that about HIV? But honestly, in all jokes aside, all I'm trying to say is the fight against HIV is something that all of us should take personally, like at an individual level. Know your status. Try to be safe. Try to test. Try to be faithful. Okay, that one is not really realistic. So we have to stick to being safe. Is there, are there any people that actually are faithful in the universe? I've never found anyone, but they tell me, it's like a myth, like how they tell you that there was a god called Zeus and Poseidon. You've never seen them, but you believe maybe they were there. They tell me that there are people who are faithful, like they sleep with only one person. I'm like, okay, wow, I wish to meet them. But that one is very hard. So let's do the realistic ones, right? Know your status. First of all, then use protection, or you test before you test each other. Stay together so that at least none of you is spreading the virus from point A to point B. Anyway, let's go for a short break. We shall be right back with more madness.